All right.
Okay, so I just.
Oops. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Cindy Schmitz. I'm the nurse practitioner in the burn and wound service here at UW Hospital. And they've asked me to talk today about wound care in our PEDS population. So my background is in, as I said, is in primarily in burn, and we tend to work with some of the more complex, extensive wounds. So I'm taking those approaches, and hopefully we can apply them to the types of wounds that you're seeing in the primary care setting. I think some of the pretty much the four main components of good wound healing in general, I always start with pain control, because we'll never do good wound care if we don't have good pain control. We'll talk about that a little bit. Wound cares themselves, kind of what we do to the wound, how we clean it, what dressings we put on, etc. And then when wounds aren't healing up lickety-split, I think that there's kind of two things that sometimes we have to look at and see. So one is good edema control when you've got a wound that it might not even seem like the limb, that a wound on an extremity is swollen, but if you even have some edema in the skin itself, it slows down the blood flow to the wound and can slow down healing. And then lastly, good nutrition, and specifically protein intake. So especially in some of our more chronically ill kids or kids who aren't taking in good nutrition, that can play a part in slowing down the healing process. So just a little quick talk about pain control. I think it's the real component is we need to think about treating pain to adequately clean the wound at the time that you're cleaning the wound, but then also just to be able to do life activities. We tend to break up our pain control into the mindset of background pain and procedural pain. So background pain is typically handled by either a dressing that covers the wound to keep it less uncomfortable, keeping the swelling out of the wound, because a dependent wound that's swelling tends to throb and be more painful. Basically, over-the-counter medicines, and in more painful, kind of longer present wounds, we tend to lean towards some gabapentin for some good long-acting pain medication, because a lot of the pain that you have with wounds is nerve pain from the exposed nerves in the wound bed. And then procedural pain, meaning right before you wash the wound, about an hour beforehand, giving pain medicine to help make sure that it's working at the time that we're going to wash the wound. If probably most of the smaller wounds that you're dealing with in the community, you don't really need a lot of background pain medicines, so that you can just jump right to either pre-medding with ibuprofen or Tylenol. We do, having said that though, if wounds can't be washed or cleaned adequately with just over-the-counter meds, sometimes you have to give an opioid for that procedural wound care, because we tend to use Tylenol a fair bit for background pain. We're tending to use oxycodone solution with our little kids, or oxycodone pills or Percocet. If you're not giving Tylenol in the background, you can combine it for this point. So here's the big thing, washing the wounds. I think that all wounds need to be washed regularly. If you are washing them regularly, the chance of them getting infected or having complications around that are actually quite low. When we talk about washing wounds, we're not talking about rinsing it with like a saline, kind of pouring over it, a little bit of water sprinkling over it. I'm actually talking about washing the wound, which is rubbing on the wound, with the intent of removing the buildup of debris, of slough, of drainage, the loose skin, if it's like a burn or a blister. And by doing that, you're decreasing the bacterial load on the wound surface, hopefully breaking down some of that kind of biofilm that tends to build up if it's not disrupted at all. If it hurts too much to wash the wound, I take us back to the previous slide, and we just need to rethink about better pain control and better pain medications. I think that also with kids, you always have to think about anxiety and distraction playing into it. So that's where child life is helpful for us in our world. But anything that you can do to help distract the child. And if we're not successful that way, I think that's when you're at a time, if you're accessible at that point, you're at a time that you should reconsider whether this is even attainable in an outpatient setting. And the reality is given the choice, wounds should be washed in the shower or the bathtub, and just wash them with a clean washcloth, soap and water, wash the wound with it before you've washed other parts of the body or use a new clean washcloth at that time. The germs on their body are their germs, and having the water run over it or being in the bathtub with them is fine. Just using soap and water and washing the wound. That's my soapbox. So this is a picture actually of a child who is, I will tell you, is sedated before I click this and it starts working. So when we talk about, work please. Come on. Okay, well, what you would be seeing if the, it's delaying on there. Sorry about that. So what you would be seeing is actually taking a washcloth. You can kind of see this. You've got that loose, blistery skin there, and washing over that entire thing. And I'm talking about washing like you would wash your skin if you had dirt on it. So you're actually applying some pressure, and removing the loose debris, the loose skin, and getting it to get down to a nice clean wound surface. If we leave debris or that loose skin on the wound surface, the dressings that you put on top of that aren't actually on the wound bed. So you actually have a little like roof there for bacteria or other stuff to collect. So sorry about the lack of that slide moving forward. There we go. So everything starts out with washing the wound. After that, I think there's a few basic approaches to wound care. So for the average superficial wound, I'm talking about a superficial road rash or scrape, small blisters, whether it be from, touching something hot or ill-fitting shoes or all the different things that you are running into for smaller acute blistery type wounds. But wounds that aren't deep, I think the using some kind of a topical antimicrobial ointment and a nonstick dressing, whether that is, if it's small enough, a Band-Aid type dressing or there's different brands of a non-adherent, like an Aquaphor or different brands of a non-adherent dressing or like Telfa, things like that. As far as what topical antimicrobial to use, we use bacitracin. Some people use Neosporin, that's what they have in their homes. Neosporin has a tendency to have a little bit more contact dermatitis or irritation from it. So, and then if you've got a child that you're dealing with that has a history of some staph aureus, or if you're a little concerned about there being a little bit more of a staph growth, using bactrobipurecin is another option that would treat the same way. If you have a deeper burn or a burn that has more necrotic tissue stuck to it, a lot of dead tissue on it, or if it's got a fair bit of erythema around the wound and you're thinking, is this wound have more leaning towards an infected appearing wound? Sylvadine is a good broad spectrum antimicrobial. And when you're using Sylvadine, we don't put a non-adherent dressing over that. We actually put gauze over that. Because if you think about it, you're putting that on a wound that has dead tissue. So I kind of want the Sylvadine to soften up that dead tissue and the gauze to, I'm going to say stick, but it doesn't stick like dried on stick because it should stay a little bit moist. So that when you wash it away, you take some of that dead tissue with it. So that hopefully with the next dressing change, you're getting down to a cleaner wound bed that doesn't have dead tissue. And then there's a lot of designer wound dressings that are out there. At the end, I'm just going to throw in the one that we're most commonly using, which is a form of a silver impregnated foam dressing that can be left on for many days at a time. But like I said, there's we could talk all day about all the different designer wound dressings that are out there. So to kind of go into a little bit more detail about those different types of wound treatments. So bacitracin and a non-adherent gauze. I have some pictures of some different types of wounds. We have a smaller scald burn on an 8-year-old child. That's what it looks like after it's been washed. Okay. Here's another picture of a road rash, a child who, actually this is from a treadmill, fell and the treadmill ran, kind of what it initially looked like after being washed the first time, and then a few, about a week later after having had dressings. And that you could use the best tracing approach with that. Or here's another one where a child, I'm calling it road rash, actually this fell off his bike and in the process caught his hand on parts of the wheel in the road and scraped. So these are just other smaller lacerations on like a 6-year-old here. So those are all types of wounds that you could potentially consider managing with bacitracin and a non-adherent dressing. Important thing that you're looking at is you think they're partial thickness. You think the dermis is left behind. Therefore, the wound can heal up from the wound base. Okay. The wound is relatively clean. It's moist. It doesn't have a lot of eschar or dead tissue stuck to it. You have to have a child that's able to have the dressing changed. A bacitracin is a we do it daily in young children or twice a day in older children and adults. What tends to happen is over the course of like 12 hours in or so, it just tends to dry out a little bit more. So if they're able to tolerate changing it a second time, it's a little bit better for the wound itself. With our younger kids, if it's going to be traumatizing, it's just not worth it. And we would just deal with it then, drying out a little bit. So a little bit of the steps. Okay, I know this isn't a child, but this is my slides for the steps of kind of doing that bacitracin wound care. So we give the pain medication an hour beforehand, wash the wound with soap and water, make sure to remove any of that loose scab or drainage. You apply the bacitracin to the open area, and then apply that non-adherent dressing, non-adherent gauze over that. You can see down here, that's this kind of petroleum impregnated looking dressing here. And then secure that in place with gauze of some sort. And then we apply compression later. Like I said, we want to have something that gently squeezes on that wound bed to help just get the edema or the swelling out of the skin itself so that we have better blood flow to the wound. It will speed up healing and decrease your risk of scarring in the long run if it's a wound that takes longer to heal. You'll notice on the face up here, actually I left this in primarily because we don't put all those dressings on faces for the most part. If someone has a scrape or something on their face, we tend to just put the bacitracin ointment on and reapply during the day just to keep it moist and then washing it. In the evening, when you're doing the dressings for twice a day, you just repeat the applying of the ointment. You don't have to wash it the second time of the day. In full thickness burns or wounds, that's when we would use the Silvadine or a more broad spectrum antimicrobial cream. This is a contact burn. It's just my best example of this. This is like white leathery eschar, person trying to remove a tattoo that they didn't want anymore. So white leathery eschar that is from a contact burn, that's full thickness. If that heals, it's gonna heal from the wound margins in. It's not gonna heal from the wound base up because there isn't any dermis left behind to supply the epidermis out of the skin appendages, feeling back to your skin anatomy to help re-epithelialize that wound. So healing of this wound will either heal from the wound edges in or someone will come and excise it and put on a skin graft lightly. So in that scenario, a wound that looks like that you know is full thickness, that's where we would, once again, pre-medicate with pain medication, wash the wound with soap and water. That doesn't change no matter what you put on it. Apply the Silvadine cream to the open areas and that have the necrotic, the dead tissue. So for example, over here, where this is more pink, and actually in this picture, I think it's almost beginning to heal. The whole wound looked like that, I would have gone the bacitracin route the previous slide. So you put the Silvadine in gauze, dry gauze right on top of that, apply your compression layer to help keep the edema out of the skin, and then in the evening, repeat the first, last three steps. So a little bit about when burns are bigger than, are more complex or wounds even that are more complex than what what you can handle in the outpatient setting. So our approach for pediatric burns or complex wounds is they're admitted for initial debridement under a moderate sedation is what we do with our kids. And at that time, with pretty much across the board, our practice these days is to apply a silver impregnated foam dressing to the burn wound. And then after it's been well debrided, and then apply the dressings over that. And then once the child is back to baseline, eating, drinking, all that stuff, we find that having that foam dressing in place actually is pain control in and of itself. Most of our kiddos were able to discharge to home and then have them come back every 3 to 7 days for serial outpatient short stay visits where they get a moderate sedation with oral medications and get their wound cares redone. Sometimes they go back into the dressing, sometimes they're healed. And then over the course of usually about 2 weeks, the wounds heal up, and the children that the wounds are deeper and need to have a surgical solution for healing, then we'll plan a return and actually go to the operating room. So that, as far as bigger wounds go, that's our approach. So a little bit about one of the designer, I'm gonna call it the designer dressings that are out there, that silver impregnated foam dressing. It is really important to wash the wounds again, very well to remove you're doing almost the equivalent of a surgical scrub at this point, because you want to get down all the debris. So you have a wound that as you put a dressing on that you're leaving in place for 3 to 7 days, you're not leaving behind bacteria. Although the dressings do have silver in them, they do knock back some antimicrobial growth. They're not perfect. And if you have a dirty wound underneath there, you will get an infection that will grow. Securing the wounds with gauze and then compression. In these pictures here, like here's an example of a child who has burns actually over her head, down her neck and her trunk, and on one of her arms, kind of up and about running around playing because her wounds are covered and pretty pain-free. And another older person who has burns to their face that we do this dressing on, even for faces. So, as far as larger wounds go, this approach has pretty much taken over how we manage complex wounds in our kids. So that's my quick down and dirty about wound care. Are there any questions?
Awesome, thanks, I'll just stop sharing. So, oh, that was fantastic. And just like a great reminder to me about how there's some complexity, but there's also some, you know, sort of basic principles simple that you follow. What are your thoughts on, this is a question I've actually heard a couple different perspectives on, but like mm-hmm. in the general surgery world, we'll often do like wet to dry dressings, you know, where we'll have sort of gauze in the wound bag, mm-hmm. we'll change it a couple times a day. I assume you would advocate for washing those as well, like just in the shower or something?
Yeah, so if anybody, pretty much kids or adults, they can get in the shower. If you've got a wound that's like open to a cavity that you're not positive, that you're not pooling.
Right.
What, yeah.
You're but like, that's where the intestines are going to fall.
Right, out, exactly. That, yeah. I'm not pouring. You know,
yeah.
But pretty much every other wound, if you can wash it with soap and then, because most of it's usually it's abdominal or other wounds that mm-hmm. are kind of just open to the fascia, closed fascia, but you're, down. Yeah.
Pilonidal.
Yeah.
Sometimes.
Yep. Yeah. Soap and water, and okay. we do a fair bit of wet to dry. If the wounds looks mucky, we'll do Dakins, mm-hmm. Half strength Dakins, and twice a day usually. If that's just not enough, turning it around, sometimes we'll bump it up to 3 or 4 times a day. I hate to have to do that if we can avoid it, because it's just that takes over their life.
Yeah.
But
when you say soap and water, any thoughts on what are good and bad soaps?
I have two thoughts. So one is in the hospital, we use HipaCleanse because that's what the hospital says we have to have used that in other parts of their body. Mm-hmm. And I do think it's a decent antimicrobial. In the community, we tend to just say Dial or some kind of a decent soap. I'd like the soaps to have surfactant, and all this HipaCleanse that we have now in our hospital, the pink stuff doesn't have a surfactant to it. Mm. It's just if you wash your hands with it, it either comes out foam and it's just
right.
But it's not like if you think about when you prep with, right? Do you prep with Hibiclens or Betadine?
I usually prep with ChloraPrep.
Okay. So that is flat. So that's actually the same stuff that's in that pink stuff. It's not, it doesn't have a surfactant, but like if you prep with the Hibiclens that's in the chlorhexidine that's in the bottles and you scrub with that, that soaps up.
Right.
Because that has a surfactant in it, but the hospital doesn't use that right now. So,
okay. So
I like using something with surfactant because it does soft break up some of that biofilm.
Yeah.
So,
but no need to use a specific like antimicrobial soap.
No. And if I have patients that say, oh, I only use Aveeno because that's the soap that works best on my skin or whatever brand it is.
Yeah.
Insert brand here. That's fine. Okay. Soap and water. It's really washing on the wound that matters.
Yeah. And what about for dressings? I've heard two schools of thought on this. Like, must use saline versus you can use tap water, whatever, right? Don't use lake water.
Yeah. Well, don't use lake water. I think that I've run into a little bit of a problem on occasion with homes that have like well water. I'm a little hesitant to have them stick that in their wound. Mm-hmm. I don't think it has to be saline. I think it could be.
Yeah.
Bottled water. And this is way cheaper than
tap water.
Than by,
right. And harder to, you know, it's just hard to come by.
It's hard to come by saline. I think that, you know, I know some people feel more strongly about that. And I do know that like some of our immunosuppressed populations, they feel more strongly that you have to use some kind of a sterile.
Right.
Presumably
these wounds are not like.
They're not sterile.
Sterile.
Most of the ones that I'm dealing with aren't sterile. Yeah.
Yeah.
And honestly, a lot of our wounds, like the necrotizing soft tissue infections or the kind of the, which you don't get that much of in kids, but in the adults where it's all like groins.
Mm-hmm.
Areas that just aren't dry ever.
Right, yeah.
So a lot of the wounds like that, if it's a really mucky wound, we'll actually pack it with a dry gauze because the wound itself
the wound
is pouring out enough moisture that it's not, exactly.
Yeah.
So it's their own, so if you have, what you don't want to do is put dry in and have it come out dry because then you're going to desiccate the wound bed. But as long as it's coming out moist, damp.
Yeah, getting over that idea of like scrubbing, I think is
people have a hard time.
Challenging, but like it makes sense, right? You want to help debris
get
out of there, and like the body may be able to get rid of it eventually on its own, but you can accelerate that process and get back to healthy tissue.
And my mindset, I don't know so much in some of our kids because it's in those chronic wounds that people have had for forever.
Mm-hmm.
The body, the way I describe it, is like it kind of, the body's taken that wound and it's put it kind of in like in the back of the junk drawer. And there's all these other things that it's going to clean for, take care of first. And by wiping on the wound, you're scrubbing it, the body's like, what the heck? You just cause like a little bit of acute trauma to the wound.
Yeah.
And so hopefully it moves it more up to the front of the pay attention to me and try and get me to heal.
If you get a little bit of bleeding in that process.
I like a little bit of bleeding
that's
in that process.
A sign of good work.
Yes. Right? Yeah.
But you don't need to scrape everything.
Right. Back. Seldom. Yeah. Yeah. Seldom do we have people that will scrub too much.
Overwash.
Yes. Yeah. Usually they work for me or with us, work with me.
Right,
it's our kind of team that's like, I'm like, you guys, it's okay. We can let those skin buds live.
Cool. And then in terms of like amount of like bacitracin and sulvidine, when I approach Bassi, I think like make the skin shiny. And when I approach sulvidine, I'm like, pretend you're making cupcakes.
Mm-hmm. I think I think one of the big things for both of them, though, is try and keep it within the wound margins.
Mm, okay.
And sulvidine, for the most part, people know where the wound edge ends because that's the kind of wound you're putting on. Bacitracin, I think a lot of times faces or like small areas that like the wound's healed up in 3/4 of it, and you really just need to paint 2 or 3 spots. If you keep smearing it on, that's where you're going to knock back your staff or have a yeast overgrowth or...
Okay.
Have a contact dermatitis just from smearing it for too long. Yeah.
Yeah.
So exactly what you described is the amount I put on, but I try and start painting spots as we get closer to healing.
And when would you say for primary care docs who are doing wound care, you know, straightforward road rash, kid comes to the pediatrician, they put Bassi on it, they tell the patient to come back. At what point should like a primary care person sort of say like, oh, this is getting past what I'm comfortable with? Or like, when do you make a referral to someone who's a wound specialist?
Yeah, I think the two things that I think, well, probably 3 times that I see it. One is pain. Mm-hmm. I think they just can't with the routine pain control that they're comfortable with. I think that triggers sending kids. I think another is they're concerned about getting infected, which 9 out of 10 times what looks like is an infected wound is probably a wound that just wasn't washed enough. So just, you're getting a fair bit of erythema around the wound because it's just got all that heavy debris, that biologic dead stuff sitting there and the body's responding to it. You wash that off and the erythema goes away. Or in that scenario, or it's not compressed and they're getting swollen and then that causes redness. And I would say the other time is if the wound's not healing. You've been doing all the right things and you're 2-3 weeks into this. A kid should be healed in 2 weeks for the most part. A kid should be healed in 2 weeks.
What point is it like?
Yeah.
I mean, is it taking too long?
For a straightforward wound, I would say. 2 weeks. I mean, most kids are healed in 2 to 3 weeks. I can't think of most straightforward things that aren't. I mean, maybe, like you said, the post-op surgical wounds that are healing from the edges.
Some nutritional, compromised kid.
But if things are, if you're just not making the progress you think you should, that's the time. Unfortunately, we are currently we have a wait list right now.
Yeah.
I think that we don't have a lot of kids that get referred that don't get in sooner than that, because I think usually that comes via one of us.
And this is to like the wound care.
Clinic. Burn is easy. Burn always comes in. That just always comes in, but more of like complex wounds of help us get this wound to heal. We have a significant wait list, but I think for the most part that's bypassed by kids.
And maybe we should just review kind of quickly when the PCP should be thinking like a burn kid needs to go to a burn center.
So I think that, the American Burn Association has referral criteria. Mm-hmm. I think anytime you have a burn that, and kind of a burn that you can't do what we just talked about, how we're going to manage the wound.
Yeah.
That child should go to a burn center.
Right.
I think that small burns that you can manage in the community and you can bring them into the appointment and that you can wash it there. Or mom says she's washing it in the tub at home, putting a Band-Aid or something on it and it's working. That doesn't need to come.
Hand across joints.
Right. And that's what I was going to say. So if you have burns to like the face, to the perineal areas, to the hands or feet, those are kind of specialized areas that if things aren't handled quite right, you can have some significant complications. But then also, honestly, with the onset, with the use of our silver impregnated foam dressing that we're using, you're taking kids from having to do wound care every single day to doing it once or twice a week.
Right.
I personally, if it was me, I'd have a hard time not saying just about any wound.
Yeah.
I'd want my kid to have it on. So if there's much pain with it, I think it's
right. It's going to be a problem. Get to a more specialized center that has more specialized material.
Yep.
Fantastic.
Would you handle the wounds differently if people had immunosuppression of some kind?
I wouldn't on our end because we're pretty aggressive with how we're cleaning them up, et cetera. I think that I just might have a little, I might not go quite so long between wound cares. If I'm using a dressing that can be extended time, I might not go for 7 whole days. I might only go 3 to 4 just to make sure that we're not getting behind the eight ball and not knowing it. Cause you're not looking at the wound. And if something, comes up, but for the most part, as long as they're, able to tolerate wound care, I think that in and of itself should be enough. Now, I'm not talking about like the type of wounds I'm talking about. I'm talking about like dog, cat bites and things like that. That's a whole nother discussion as far as antibiotics. And
right. Things that are like,
I'm talking about your, right. Inherent things that you just need to be more on. But as far as just the scrapes and the bumps and the bruises and the.
Okay. But if you stepped on a nail, for example, that would be
That's a different story. Yeah. That's really, that's more in the cat bite care category. There are specific things that needs as far as tetanus, probably some antibiotics, depending on how far the nail went in, things like that.
Okay. So it's generally, is it like puncture wounds or just like things that you know are infected?
Puncture wounds, I think, definitely need to be treated differently and should be evaluated. I think that except there's bite wounds in general have a different, if you know you, whatever, they cut it and then they stuck their hand in the culvert of manure, I might have a different view.
Right. I mean, absolutely. You know,
this is Wisconsin.
Like you've scraped it.
You scraped yourself on the road going to school versus scraped yourself falling into the manure pit. That's a whole nother scrape.
Yeah. But. Awesome. Great. Right, well, thank you so much. Thanks for being our capstone performer for the surgical indications and continuity in kids echo. This has been so fantastic. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you. All right.